Today we will be taking another step forward in our series, Increase is Coming. This will be the second part. In the first part, we talked about how to prepare for increase. We talked about different ways in which you can prepare for increase. We mentioned that increase is the empowerment that God gives unto a man that enables him to accomplish more in his plan and his program for a man's life. We also talked about increase coming into a man's life, always being in line with the plan and the program that God has for each individual. We'll be continuing today with how to receive increase. How to receive increase. And our text will be from the book of Mark chapter 11 verse 24. How to receive increase. Mark 11 24. It's a very popular passage of scripture. And as we share from it, I believe the Holy Spirit will speak to you and me in the name of Jesus. Mark 11 24. It says, therefore I say unto you, whatever you desire when you pray, believe that you receive it and you shall have it. Therefore I say unto you, whatever you desire when you pray, believe that you receive it and you shall have it. There are three different stages that are involved in prayer or any action that we take in accessing spiritual blessings, as illustrated in that passage of scripture. It says, whatever you desire when you pray, believe that you receive it and you will have it. The first stage is praying, turning your desire into a request. It says, whatever you desire when you pray. Then the second stage is believe that you receive. And the third stage is having it. Many a times in the body of Christ, we omit the middle part. We pray, then we expect to have, without going through the process that lies in between, as believing that we receive. Believing that we receive is different from the actual experience of having it. And this is where many Christians seem to miss it. Because a lot of times we take the experience as faith. The experience is actually the testimony, but before the experience comes, there are certain things that we actually have to do after we have prayed. It is putting our faith into action. The Greek word for receive is the same word that is used for take. So we can rewind that passage of scripture and says, whatever you desire when you pray, take it by faith and you will have it. Believing that you receive is a step of faith. It is applying our faith in action. We have prayed because we know that God will always answer our prayers. We have expressed our desire in our request. Now, what are the steps that we need to take for us to actually experience, that is, having it this time? That is what we're going to be dealing with in this passage of scripture. We have known in the last part that increase is actually ours and that God has ordained it for you and for me. Now, it is time for us to experience it. And the steps that we'll be taking to experience is what we'll be dealing with in this series. Father, we thank you for your word that is about to come. We ask that it will come with power. It will come as light shining upon the darkness on the pathways of your people. That even your people may experience this increase that you have prepared in the name of Jesus. Amen. The first step that we must take if we must receive increase is that we must set the stage through order. We must set the stage through order. When God wants to release increase into the life of any believer, the first thing that he looks out for is whether things are in order. He could begin the process of multiplying or increasing us. But when he comes in contact with disorder, then the work stops. Because God will never operate in an atmosphere of chaos or disorder. Order is always very important. Paul states it, he says, let all things be done decently and in order. Order is very important. In Numbers chapter 7 verse 1 to 5. Numbers 7 1 to 5. There's a story there of Moses, the prophet of God, after he had set up the tabernacle according to the instructions that God gave him. He anointed the whole thing and set the stage. And immediately he did that, without soliciting for help, the leaders of the 12 tribes started bringing gold and silver on a daily basis unto him. Why? Because he already set the stage to receive it. If you must experience increase in your life, you must first of all put up a structure that will accommodate that increase. When that structure is not in place, then you are simply saying you are not qualified to receive the increase. When you ask God to increase you, you must set up a structure that will receive it. If he's going to release blessings, he will first of all check that the things that he's going to release would be called into a place where it will be properly handled. Order is very important. Acts chapter 6, Acts chapter 6 verse 1 to 7 tells the story of the early Christians when they began to multiply. And God began to greatly multiply the number of the Christians. Then rank up began amongst them, and that stopped the work of increase until the apostles had to put things in order. They had to set up boards of deacons that began to help in the administration so that they could face the assignment that God had given them. And in verse 7, the Bible says the number of the disciples greatly multiplied. Why? Because order was put in place. Jesus Christ asked his disciples to sit the people down in groups of 50s. They were a large multitude. And if they had started serving in that way, the whole thing would have been full of chaos. But Jesus Christ told them to sit them down in fifties because order needed to be put into it. If you want God to increase you, whether it's in your church or in your family, you must first of all learn to put things in the right order. God is always dealing with things in the right order. The Bible says that blessings come from the head down. A situation where the head has been placed under, then that means the blessings are going to flow into the body. In fact, when you turn yourself upside down for a very long time and you stand on your head, you would know that the body would definitely feel it. And if it lasts for too long, it could result in sickness, if not in something worse. So order is very important if God is going to release increase into the life of any believer. Let's check our lives. Check your family. Is the husband loving the wife as he should be loved? Is the wife giving honor to the husband the way it should be given? Is the church putting things in the right order to experience increase? When souls are saved, what structures have you put in place to see to it that they are discipled? When people give their lives to Christ, what structures have you put in place to ensure that they are established? When you are asking for increase in the number of people that attend your meetings, what structures have you put in place to monitor that progress, to report it, to make sure that things go as planned? It's only those that prepare for these kind of things that experience the increase. Even in your company, if you cannot properly manage 50,000, don't expect that 500,000 would come because you don't even know when it's disappearing because you have not put order in place. Order is very important if you must experience increase. Point number two on how to receive increase. You must step out in faith. You must step out in faith. Now that you have asked God to increase and you have seen according to the word of God that increase is for you, and you have caught the revelation in the word of God that He's going to increase you, you don't wait for the thing to increase in your hand. You step out in faith. Just like when you want to put up a structure, a building or anything, you don't wait until all the money comes into your hand. You step out and you start building it one block after the other. Then God begins to release the increase into your life. In 2 Kings chapter 4, 2 Kings chapter 4, verse 43 to 44, the servitor asked, he said, how can I set 20 loaves of bread before if I 100 men? And Elisha told him, he said, share it because God has already said you would eat and you would have leftover. If he had sat down and refused to step out in faith, that 20 loaves of bread would have remained 20 loaves of bread. But stepping out moved the angel of increase to work and began to multiply those loaves of bread and was able to fill the whole place. In the same way, in 2 Kings chapter 4, verse 1 to 7, 2 Kings 4, 1 to 7, until the widow of the prophet started pouring out the oil, there was no increase. If she had said all she had was just that 3 drops of oil in the container and she had refused to take the steps of collecting the vessels and pouring the oil into the container, nothing would have come. It wouldn't have happened. The oil did not multiply inside the vessel. It was during the pouring that the oil began to increase. That's exactly the way God works. You learn to step out in faith. Your move is a proof that you believe God is going to give you increase. Your step forward in the right direction is a proof that you know God is going to increase you. If your heart can only take 20 and your number is already 20 and you are asking for increase and you are refusing to remove yourself from that heart, then increase is not going to come because there will be no place for you to receive them. But when you step out in faith and you move to a heart that will take more people, then you have already provided a space and the increase will come. Isaiah 54 verse 2 to 3, he says, enlarge the place of your tent and let them stretch forth the curtains of your habitation. Spare not lengthening your cord and strengthen your stakes, because you will break forth on the right and on the left. He didn't say, break forth as you are breaking forth on the right and on the left, start enlarging the place of your tent. No, you create room for the increase to come before it comes. So how do you do this? You step out in faith, prepare room. You can move from one room onto a place that is bigger if you want more in your life. You must learn to step out. That is when increase will come. Jesus Christ's disciples started sharing the 5 loaves of bread and 2 fishes, and it began to multiply. It did not go into a warehouse and put it there and start praying and start prophesying and start praying in tongues for the thing to multiply. No, they stepped out in faith, and the 5 loaves of bread and 2 fishes fed over 5,000 people, and they still had left over. God taught me something. He said a creative ability is awakened in you the moment you decide to use what you have when you don't have what to use. When you decide to step out in faith, using what you have, and you believe God for the increase, He will awaken an ability in you that will bring about that increase. And you will be surprised that you can accomplish so much with what you have. That's how God works. Learn to step out in faith. Point number three, you must expect increase. You must expect increase. Jeremiah 29:11 says, for I know the thoughts that I have towards you, thoughts of good and not of evil, to give you a hope and a future. Another version says to bring you an expected
end. It is the end that you expect that you will experience. If you don't expect increase, you're not going to get increase. Job 8:7. He says, though your beginning be small, yet your latter end should greatly increase. That is the standard. Expect that you should increase, that you should be more than you are now. If you don't expect it, you can't experience it. Bishop Oyedepo says, expectation is the mother of manifestation. Admiral says, if you rob your seed of expectation, then you are not qualified to experience the harvest. You must expect increase. If you sow, you take steps, you apply all the principles, and you are not expecting anything, you're not going to get it. You're just like a farmer that goes to the farm and puts something in the ground and he's not expecting anything. It's only a farmer that is expecting something that will weed. It is a farmer that is expecting something that will decide to apply all the necessary things, because that will be the motivating factor to get more. It is the farmer that expects harvest that would go and begin to seek information on what to be done. And it is only that person that gets to know what to do to experience the increase. So you must learn to expect increase. If you don't expect it, you can't experience it. Point number four, you must learn to prepare your vessel. You must prepare your vessel. You must prepare your vessel. God will not pour blessings down when there are no rooms to receive it. God will not pour blessings down when there are no rooms to receive it. He can be pouring it and the thing gets full and overflowing. But when there is nothing to start with, then it is not going to start. You must have something that you are going to apply the increase into when it comes into your hand. If you don't have plans for increase, it will not come. If I ask you to mention two ministries in this country that seem to be experiencing increase in ways that blow your mind, there are two major ones that stand out. Well, when you look at these ministries, you would see that they have never stopped having projects that they are pouring money into. As the ending one, another one is starting. As the ending one, another one is coming up. That is why they're experiencing increase. Why? Because as they're asking for it, they already have something they want to use it for, and the thing keeps increasing. If you see any ministry that is not experiencing increase, it is simply because they have nothing to tie to. But when you have a project that you want God to fund, He will fund it. When you want to just give you money so you can consume it on your loss, or you so you can brag and God can give you money, no, it doesn't work like that. God wants you to have a good plan on ground. And not just a plan, a good plan. Your plan is the vessel that will receive that increase. Draw up a building plan. You can drop a plan to feed the orphans. You can drop a plan to evangelize. You can drop a plan to sponsor the kingdom. You can drop a plan to do a lot, even personal projects. If you don't have it, then there's not going to be something for God to release increase into. God taught me something. When money meets a good plan in your hand, it becomes seed. When it meets a bad plan in your hand, it leads away. Or when it meets no plan in your hand at all, it becomes bread. And God gives seed unto the sower and bread unto the eater. So it's not just enough for you to have plans. You must have a very good plan. A plan that will turn the money that is coming into your hand into seed, so that it can multiply. That is the kind of plan that you must have. Something that will be worthwhile. That is what should form the bulk of your plan. That is what should form the bulk of the program that you are drawing up for the increase that is coming for you. Something that will benefit more lives. That is what will qualify you for the increase. Because God is always interested in affecting lives. And when you commit yourself through projects that you have drawn up into that, then you qualify yourself to increase. For increase. Another vessel is for you to commit yourself to kingdom projects. When you know that there are certain projects that have been checked, and you know that they are in line with the will of God, you commit yourself to it. If God is going to release 50 million naira into a church or a ministry to accomplish a project, He's not going to pour it down from heaven. He's going to release it through those that belong or are committed to that ministry, that He knows will give, so that at least when He gives them 500 million, they will be able to pay at least their tithe, and that project will be accomplished. But if you are not a part of those that are committed to that giving, then you have not qualified yourself to be a part of them. That is how God works. Commit yourself to kingdom projects. You don't start when you have money. You start before the money comes, so that as it goes through you, there are certain things it will go through, and a vessel that carries water will never be dry. That is how it is. When God has seen that he knows that you will use this thing in the line of His will, then He will release it to you and you will have a lot even to benefit from it. Point number 5 is that you must learn to talk increase. You must learn to talk increase. He says, unto him that shows his conversation aright, I will show my salvation. Unto him that orders his conversation aright, I will show my salvation. When your words are words of decrease, or words that promote stagnation, you are not going to increase. It does not matter all the efforts that you put into it. When you are always speaking negative, because that is what you always see, you are not going to increase. When all you do is complain, it does not matter how much seed you sow, you will be killing the seed with those wrong words. Because words are the things that will produce testimony. Words are those things that angels work with. Psalm 103 verse 20, it says, the angels of God excel in strength, and they hearken to the voice of his word. When you give the word of God voice by speaking, the angels have something to work with. But when you just keep speaking wrong, then they see that because they have nothing to work with, angels will not work with your complaints, they will not work with your murmurings, they will not work with the wrong words that you speak. In fact, you are actually releasing demons to work against you when you speak wrong words. You must learn to speak increase. Disallow wrong words around you. There are some people, all they see is negative. They will never see anything good. Don't allow those people to speak around you. Don't allow them to speak into your situation. When they speak, counter it. Increase will come in response to the words that you allow to rule around your life. That means that God upholds all things by the word of his power. It does not matter if you have not made sales in 1 week. When people begin to say wrong things, don't allow them to settle. Change it. Refuse wrong words around your life. The widow of Zarephath in 1 Kings chapter 17 verse 12 said, this thing I'm going to eat, so it's just for me and my child. Immediately I finish eating it, I'm going to die. Immediately she said that Elijah took that out of her mouth and he said, since you say you're going to die, bring it. I will eat it. If that woman had eaten that thing, especially with the anointing upon the life of Elijah, just for the barren statement she had made, she and her child most likely would have died. You don't know the anointing that is present around you when you are speaking. In fact, the angels are constantly ready to carry your word and execute it. But when you speak wrong words, you are simply saying you are not qualified to experience increase. Look at the widow's son in 2 Kings chapter 4 verse 6. They were pouring oil into the vessels. And the Bible records in verse 6 of 2 Kings chapter 4 that all the vessels were filled. But the Bible didn't say the oil stopped flowing. Until the boy said, there are no more vessels. The Bible says, immediately the flow of oil stopped. It was not the lack of vessel that stopped the flow of the oil. It was the wrong word that was spoken that stopped the flow of oil. Train your children to speak the right words. If that child had been properly groomed by the mother and just said, mother, let me pour this one, I'll bring more. If it had taken them 3 days to get vessels, I believe the oil would still have continued flowing. But she said the wrong thing. She said, there are no more vessels. And immediately, the flow of increase stopped in that family. When you allow your children to speak wrong words, you are simply establishing the flow of wrong things into your family. It does not matter how hard you pray. It does not matter how hard you believe. Those words will kill all your efforts. Because it is words that sustain the earth. The earth were formed by words. He says, he upholds all things by the word of his power. When wrong words keep pouring out of your life, out of your family, you are stopping the flow of increase and you are establishing stagnation. It does not matter what your experience is. It does not matter whether it's 0 naira in your pocket. If you don't know what to say, just keep quiet. You must learn to speak increase. You must learn to speak increase. Then don't wait for signs before you speak. If you are waiting for the signs, if you are waiting for the money to come before you see, then it's not going to come. You speak as if it is already here. The Bible says that God calls those things which be not as though they were. And he does that because that is what works. He does that because that is the system that works. So if you are going to apply the principle of the kingdom of this same God, you must apply the same method. Elijah said in 1 Kings 18:41, he said there is a sound of abundance of rain. As at that time, there were no clouds gathered in the sky. There was not a drop. He said there is a sound of abundance of rain. And indeed, an abundance of rain came. Don't wait until you see it. Keep speaking it. It is what you say that you see. God said, let there be light. And there was light. And God saw that the light was good. You are created in the image of this same God. It is what you say that you will see. Do you know that you are where you are today, having the experience you are having today, because of the things that you have been saying and the things that you have been allowing people to see into your life? You may not agree with me, but that's a fact. So you must allow right words to come out of your mouth. And you don't wait for signs. You speak for the signs to show. This is whatever you desire when you pray. Believe and you receive it and you shall have it. Many of us is when the signs begin to manifest that we now begin to speak. No, you speak to see. It's already done when you pray. But your words, as you declare it, is what will create it in manifested form. Point number six, gather the fragments. Gather the fragments. Many people are not experiencing increase because they are living wastefully. There are so many people that are disqualifying themselves from the increase that they are supposed to have just because they live wastefully. Every day, eatery. Instead of cooking, they are so lazy that they would rather go to eatery. Some, every day, they buy food. Why don't you start going to buy food so and wake up early and cook when you are going to school or going to work? Some students waste their pocket money by going to restaurants every day to eat, and they think it's because they have money so they can do whatever they like. You are simply disqualifying yourself from experiencing increase. Jesse the Baptist said he was asking God for increase some time ago, and God told him he had already given him the increase. He said, Lord, how am I going to see? He said, God told him, every time you come out of your office, switch off the light and make sure that every person in your ministry office does the same. He started doing that. And at the end of the month, he discovered that just by doing that, he was able to save $5,000 on power bill. At the end of the year, $60,000. He had been doing that for a while, saving that money. When the recession came, an immediate recession came, he had money to buy properties because the value of properties came down. He had enough money to buy properties for far less than they were worth. After the economy picked up again, the price of those things went up, and he was able to sell that same property for far more. Now imagine if he had been wasting that money. Where would he have gotten the money to buy that property, even though the price came down? Learn to live a controlled life. Learn to gather the fragments. A lot of the blessings that God has given you lie in the fragments around you. But until you learn to discipline yourself and control waste, until you eliminate it in your life, you are not going to see it. You must learn to gather the fragments. You go and decide to give you a car for 20,000 naira. But if you don't have the 20,000 naira in your account as at the time the opportunity comes, how will you own it? Learn to gather fragments around you. After feeding the 5,000, just like I told his disciples, gather the fragments and let nothing be wasted. Check waste in your life. Check it and curb it. You'll be surprised how much you'll be able to keep at the end of the day. I want you to apply all these principles beginning from today, because God has a lot to release into your life. But your ability to receive it will be dependent on your preparedness. God is no respecter of persons. If he has given increase to one person, he will give it to any other person if the principle will be applied by them. As you begin to apply these principles, I see the hand of God for increase coming upon your life in the name of Jesus Christ. Whatever it is that has been choking your increase and limiting you and preventing you from moving forward, from experiencing that increase, God will begin to shatter it in the name of Jesus Christ. Whatever it is that is saying you will not be more than you are, the hand of God comes upon your efforts and begins to bring you unending increase in the name of Jesus. It is not your efforts that will bring it. Your steps are just movements in the right direction, telling God that you will handle it properly. And I pray for you that as you apply these principles, God will release his favor upon your efforts, and you will reap a thousandfold in the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you for your word that has come. We thank you because of the lives of your people that you have made up your mind to increase. Thank you because they will never remain the same after this word. We receive a fresh anointing for increase. That as your people take steps, Lord, increase will begin to back them in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father, for in Jesus' name we have prayed. Amen.